Hello, I'm Richard Murphy, and I want to talk about quantitative easing. Now, QE is really important in our economy, but what it is doing is not entirely beneficial. So this is the first of a series of videos that are going to talk about how QE can be reformed to provide a better basis for financing the future that we really need. The series will be slightly controversial to those who believe that modern monetary theory is that answer, but I believe the issues are related and that QE reform is a step on the way to the answers that we really require to create the investment that is so obviously necessary in the UK economy and the economy of other countries if we are going to become a sustainable, wealthy, in a real sense, economy in the 21st century. Now, let's start, though, with a reminder of what quantitative easing really is. QE is a process by which the government creates money. Now, that is really easy for a government to do. What the Bank of England does is lend money to a company that is, well, legally owned by it, but actually is controlled by the UK's Treasury. That's quite important that it's controlled by the Treasury, because it's very difficult for banks to make money by lending to themselves. But banks can always create money by lending to other people. The company in question is called the Bank of England Asset Purchase Finance Facility. Look, let's not worry about that, because everybody calls it the APF. And the APF borrows money in very large quantities from the Bank of England. At the moment, the sum is around 800 billion. It's rising, it's scheduled to go to nearly 900 billion. Until the beginning of 2020, the figure was around 445 billion, but it's approximately doubled in the last year. And all of that money has been created since 2009, when the global financial crisis hit, and was injected in stages, first of all, between 2009 and 2016, and now, as I say, nearly doubled in 2020. The process of money creation is very simple. It is quite simply the opening of two bank accounts. The Bank of England says in one of those accounts to the APF, we owe you money that you can spend as you wish. And the other bank account is a loan account where the APF acknowledges that it owes the Bank of England money. The APF, of course, remember being the UK government treasury in effect. Now, what happens then is that the APF, on behalf of the Treasury, goes back into the financial market and buys back the gilts that have been created and sold by the UK Treasury to, well, it is claimed, fund the UK financial deficit. Now, remember what the deficit is. Every year since 2009, in fact, in reality, almost every year since 1694, but for our current purposes, every year since 2009, the UK government has run a deficit. That simply means its spending has been greater than the taxes that it has collected from the UK economy. And to make its apparent books balance, that is, to actually make it look as though it is actually equating the cash in with the cash out, what it does is go into the financial market and sell bonds. Now, bonds are nothing special. You're probably quite familiar with the idea of having a bank deposit account or even paying or even creating a loan account with a bank or building society where for a period of 5 years or so, you might lock up your money to get a better interest rate. Well, a government bond is exactly the same as that 5 year or whatever bond account that you might have with a bank or building society. It's simply a promise to pay over a fixed period of time. The only slightly odd thing about government bonds is that instead of that account, that 5 year account, being solely between you and the bank, well, in the case of a government bond, you can actually sell the account on what is called a secondary market. So somebody can buy your account from you and get all the future benefits of the interest that you were going to be offered. Now, therefore, the opportunity exists for the Bank of England, through the APF, on behalf of the Treasury, to go into the finance markets and buy back the government's bonds. And that's exactly what they've done. 435 billion until February 2020, over 400 billion since then, and rising. Now, I'm going to avoid discussion about whether at the moment that is directly funding the government deficit or not. I will deal with that issue in this blog series. But first of all, or video series, but first of all, let's just talk about what the consequence of that is. When the government spends in the first instance, when it creates the deficit, what it does is quite simply inject new money into the economy. Because the government can do that. When the government decides to spend through the Bank of England always acts in accordance with its instructions to pay. Why wouldn't it? It's owned by the government. If the government says, please make a payment to whoever, it could be you, it could be your pension, it could be a benefit, it could be payment for your education, who cares what? If the government says, make a payment on behalf of a person or to an organisation, then the Bank of England does it. Now, it does it, of course, indirectly. It does it through the commercial banks. So it makes a payment from the government's accounts through the commercial banks to you. There's a special type of account to manage that. It's between the government and, or rather the Bank of England, and the commercial banks. They're called central bank reserve accounts. And what happens is that when the government spends, a payment goes through the central bank reserve accounts into the private sector economy. When taxes are paid, money comes back from the private economy to the government through the central bank reserve accounts. If the two don't balance, historically what the government did was sell bonds and more money came back from the private sector into the government sector through the central bank reserve accounts. So that broadly speaking, they balanced at, well, near enough, nothing. Not quite historically, but near enough the balance was held so that there was no overdraft between the government and the Bank of England. That was the goal. What actually happens under QE is that those first processes happen. The government spends, the central bank reserve accounts go up. Tax comes back in because that's what happens when the government spends. It then asks for some back as tax and then it asks some back as sale of proceeds of selling new gilts or bonds and the money comes back again. But as I've noted right at the start of this video, new money is created by the QE process, and that goes back from the government into the private sector again, through the central bank reserve accounts. They have, as a result, gone up dramatically during the period of quantitative easing. In fact, they've gone up by near enough, not precisely the same, but near enough, the same amount of money as has been created by QE. So they're standing at around £800 billion now as well. But the critical point here is that when the government first spent the money, it went to specific targets. You for your pension, or you for the benefit the NHS provided you with, or you for the benefit of your education, or whatever else. But you can see my point. It went for a specific purpose. When it goes back the second time, having been reclaimed once either through tax or bond sales, when it goes back in again through the quantitative easing process, the difficulty is that it goes into the finance sector. Now, the claim by the government is that the money that went back into the finance sector would do two things. First of all, it would, because the government had kept interest rates low, not go into low-bearing interest accounts like government bonds, because they were making those unavailable by buying them. But secondly, it would go into higher risk investments. And if you like, there's a third aspect to that, but it's linked to the second one. The higher risk investments were supposedly new investments and they were going to create new jobs and new economic activity. And so that would beat the simultaneous program of austerity that the government was pursuing, which has caused so much harm, as we know, by restricting the amount of activity in the private sector economy as a result of the failure of the government to provide stimulus to it. And QE should compensate for it. Well, QE didn't compensate for that failure to deliver money into the private sector economy via the new investment that it was supposed to deliver. Instead, QE delivered money to the finance sector for speculation. And what was speculated in? Well, all the usual things, commodities. So at the beginning of QE, a lot of basic commodity prices like oil, like iron ore, like copper and so on, the prices went up. There was actually a bit of a spike of inflation created by QE at that point. It had disappeared by 2012, near enough. But there was a brief spike. But then the money went into other aspects of the economy. In particular, it went into financial markets. So the odd pump apart, basically, vast amounts of this money went into things like stocks and shares. Actually, even bond prices were pushed up, and that was because of falling interest rates, and falling interest rates from the government push bond prices upwards. And finally, it went into something which we're all familiar with, or the vast majority of people are familiar with, and that is house prices. Because there was money available to lend for this purpose, deliberately created by the government and fueled by QE, particularly because money went into the top of the financial market, because bankers' bonuses were paid, as they had always been, as a consequence of QE money flooding the banks. So QE did not deliver what was hoped for it. It did keep inflation down. It did keep banks solvent. It did stop there being a major banking crisis. It did therefore keep the economy going in 2009 when there was a risk that it would fail. And incidentally, it did the same again in March 2020 when there was a risk of another banking crisis. So let's talk about the plus side of QE and say it does work in that short-term way, but it didn't provide a long-term stimulus, which is what it was meant to do. And that's a failing of QE. So as a policy, QE has become normal. It was once called unconventional, but it's now totally conventional. But it's not delivered what was hoped. It has not created an economic boom to match the amount of money that the government put into the economy to supposedly stimulate it to compensate for the austerity that it was providing in the remainder of the economy by shrinking government spending. As such, there's very good argument to say that QE has not worked. And that's why in the next video, I want to talk about what the alternatives to this type of QE are. Thanks for watching. If you're interested in what I've been saying in this video, please subscribe. There is a button below the viewing screen. If you're interested in what I have to say on Twitter, I'm at Richard J. Murphy on that medium. If you want to look at my blog, that's taxresearch.org.uk. And we have a Facebook page as well, Richard J. Murphy. So one of those things will get you more information on what this video series is about. And I hope I'll see you again soon.